Well, go ahead and open up your Bibles to the book of Ruth, chapter 2. We're going to be taking on Ruth chapter 2 today. If you forgot your Bible or you don't have one, there's some at the front over here. Please feel free to grab one, or if you need one, flag us down. We'll get one to you and make sure that you have one there. The book of Ruth, it is right after Judges and right before 1 Samuel. So if you're having trouble finding it, don't worry about it. It's really small. There's only four chapters. It's easy to flip right past it and to miss it. But if you find Judges or 1 Samuel, you're close. So that's an easy way to kind of figure it out there. So Ruth chapter 2, we're going to be taking a look at the entire chapter together today. The book of Ruth, if you remember last week, it begins with tragedy. It begins with this heartache as Naomi and her family leave God's protection. And as they leave the protection of God, they go into the world and they end up more empty than they were when they left. They thought that somehow it was going to be a good move for them. Somehow they would be able to go into Moab, which represents the world, and they would be able to experience more life. They would gain more from that. But the reality is that they're left more empty. And that's always what sin does. Have you noticed that in your life? That sin always does this. It promises you something. There's a temptation involved, right? There's something I want, and sin promises to give it to you. And as we look at what sin promises to give to us, there's a temptation for us to jump into that, to say, okay, this is going to be good. This is going to be something that I want. It's going to provide for me something that I need. And so sin promises this, but have you ever noticed that sin always fails to deliver? It never actually gives you what you're hoping to get from it. And in fact, it does the exact opposite. What you're hoping to receive, it actually steals from you. It takes away from you. And we see that exact reality taking place in the life of Naomi and Elimelech and their two sons as they move to Moab and they live there. And it's 10 years, a decade of disobedience. And throughout that 10-year period of time, Naomi's husband dies, her sons die, and she's left empty. It's always what takes place. But Naomi decides that she's going to return to the Lord. And today we're going to see that Naomi and Ruth are blessed by God far more than they could have ever thought possible. That when Naomi left Bethlehem, she was thinking that she was empty. And she concludes, if you look at chapter 1, verse 21, it says this. Naomi says, I went out full, and the Lord has brought me home again empty. She thought she was empty when she left, right? That's why she left. There's a famine in the land. We got to get more. There's something else out there. But at the end of this decade of disobedience, she comes to her senses. She comes back to the reality of, I was full then. It may have felt hard. It may have been difficult. There may have been a famine in the land. But if I would have remained in the place where the Lord was, then I would have remained in a good place. I was more full than I realized. And now I'm returning empty. Now I realize what I've lost. And as she comes back, they're doing so just thinking that maybe they're going to survive, not expecting for God's blessing upon them. But today what we're going to see is that God begins to heap blessing upon their lives. That as they return to the Lord, that this is what he's doing. That we've got to get this straight in our minds of who God is. That God, one of the ways that he reveals himself in Scripture is as a father. He reveals himself as a father. And being a dad, this helps me to understand God. That when I had kids, I gained a new perspective on who God was. Because I was able to relate to God in terms of the way that I relate to my kids. That they don't do anything to earn my love. In fact, they do the opposite of everything to earn my love. When you have children, they keep you up at night. What my oldest, I remember when we're new parents, we don't know what we're doing. We have this little baby and she cries in the middle of the night and we're trying to figure out what to do with this. And so Micah and I set up this routine. The routine was, I'll change the diaper, she'll feed the baby, so we'll kind of tag team this thing, okay? And so we're both sleep deprived, we're not sure what's going on. And I remember when I was changing her diaper one night, that she was in, we had her on the bed and I put her on the bed, kind of away. She was at least 6 inches on the bed. And I remember I was changing her diaper and I grabbed her little legs. And as I did this, you kind of do the one-handed feet thing, one foot here, one foot there, and then you like push their legs up. Well, what I didn't realize was that was going to be a pumping action for her stomach. And so a stream of liquid poo is shooting at me. And I literally jump back out of the way, and my hand smacks the wall, and it goes all the way off the bed onto the floor, right? And Micah hears me hitting the wall and yelling, you know, and it's 2 a.m, and she's like, "What's going on?" She was in the restroom or something. And I go, "She shot it at me," you know? I'm sleep deprived, I'm getting poop shot at me. They get older, they break your stuff. Like, there's nothing kids do to earn your love. But you love them. It's just in you. I would walk through fire for you. There's nothing I wouldn't do to take care of you. You've got to get that thought in your head about who God is. There is always this consistent, constant thing about God being this big, mean God. That he's got this frowny face, and he, you know, even the Lego version of God, he's got this mean look on his face, you know? Like, that's not God. He's not looking at you that way. If he wanted to punish you, then he could destroy you. If he was looking to come after you for your sin, then you would gain hell. That's what you would receive. God is not punishing you. Yes, there are things that he'll use to discipline you. Yes, like with Naomi, she's incurring the result of her failure to follow the Lord. And there's these consequences that naturally happen in life. So she's enduring that. But even in all that, God's not mad at her. God doesn't hate her. God has grace upon grace to pour out on her. He's going to heap grace upon her in a way that she never would have imagined. You see, you can't earn or deserve it because that's who God is. A couple of verses just to kind of point this out for you and illustrate this for you. James chapter 4, verse 8, in the beginning of that, it says this: "Draw near to God and he will draw near to you." Now, this doesn't position you in a place where you're somehow initiating relationship with God. No, God is beckoning you into this relationship. He is saying, "I'm inviting you in. And if you would come near to me, I will draw nearer to you." That it's my obedience to what God is calling me into that opens up a deeper level of relationship. Matthew chapter 6, verse 33 says this. Jesus speaking, he says, "Seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and he will give you everything you need." We're seeing these spiritual truths being worked out in the life of Naomi and Ruth, aren't we? That today, as we look at chapter 2, we're going to see that God draws near to them, that he takes care of their needs, that he in fact gives them more than they would ever need. And this is who our God is. This is the way that he functions. That he is looking to pour grace upon you. It's like this a pitcher of water ready to be dumped out all over you. And all we've got to do is position ourselves correctly. When we position ourselves correctly, the grace falls on us. And so that's what we see them doing. They're drawing near to the Lord. They've come back to God. And in coming back to God, grace is being poured out on their lives. That's what's taking place. And that's our main thought for the day. Our big idea is this: obedience to God positions you correctly to receive the grace he has already planned to pour out on you. That's a loaded sentence. Think through that for a second. God has already planned grace to pour into your life. His thoughts are to give you a future and a hope, not to destroy you. That God's thoughts and plans toward you are good thoughts. The Bible tells us that God has more thoughts about you than there are sand and all the seashores and all the world. And they're good thoughts. I don't have a problem thinking that maybe God thought about me, but thinking that God thinks good things about me, that's where I kind of have a struggle with it. But to know that this is the heart of our Father God, our good dad, God, that he loves me and his grace is positioned to pour out on me, but I've got to get myself under that flow of grace. And the way you do that is obedience. It's obedience. That as I'm obedient, then the flow of grace can just pour out and dump all over me, and I can experience more of God's presence, more of God's direction, more of God's leading, more of God in my life. So let's read Ruth chapter 2 together, and then we'll go back through and break it down with one another. Ruth chapter 2 verse 1 says this. Excuse me. "There is a relative of Naomi's husband, a man of great wealth, of the family of Elimelech. His name was Boaz. So Ruth, the Moabitess, said to Naomi, please let me go to the field and glean heads of grain. Glean means just pick up what's left over. Okay, so if we're not really familiar with that term, it doesn't mean to harvest. It means just to kind of pick up what's there. Okay, that's gleaning. To glean heads of grain after him in whose sight I may find favor. And she said to her, go, my daughter. Verse 3. Then she left and went and gleaned in the field after the reapers. And she happened to come to the part of the field belonging to Boaz, who was of the family of Elimelech. Now, behold, Boaz came from Bethlehem and said to the reapers, the Lord be with you. And they answered him, the Lord bless you. Then Boaz said to his servant, who was in charge of the reapers, whose young woman is this? So the servant who was in charge of the reapers answered and said, this is the young Moabite woman who came back with Naomi from the country of Moab. And she said, please let me glean after and gather after the reapers among the sheaves. So she came and has continued from morning until now, though she rested a little in the house. Then Boaz said to Ruth, you will listen, my daughter, will you not? Do not glean in another field, no, nor go from here, but stay close to my young women. Let your eyes be on the field which they reap and go after them. Have I not commanded the young men not to touch you? And when you are thirsty, go to the vessels and drink from what the young men have drawn. So she fell on her face and bowed to the ground and said to him, why have I found favor in your eyes that you should take notice of me since I am a foreigner? And Boaz answered and said to her, it has been fully reported to me all that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband, and how you have left your father and your mother and the land of your birth and have come to a people whom you did not know before. The Lord repay your work and a full reward be given to you by the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings you have come for refuge. Verse 13. Then she said, let me find favor in your sight, my Lord, for you have comforted me and have spoken kindly to your maidservant, though I am not like one of your maidservants. Now Boaz said to her, at mealtime, come here and eat of the bread and dip your piece of bread in the vinegar. So she sat beside the reapers, and he passed parched grain to her, and she ate and was satisfied and kept some back. And when she rose up to glean, Boaz commanded his young men, saying, let her glean even among the sheaves, and do not reproach her. Also let her glean from the bundles, or let grain from the bundles fall purposely for her, and leave it that she may glean, and do not rebuke her. So she gleaned even in the field until evening, and beat out the wheat that had been gleaned, and it was about an ephah of barley. Then she took it up and went into the city, and her mother-in-law saw what she had gleaned. So she brought it out and gave her what she had kept back after she had been satisfied. And her mother-in-law said to her, where have you gleaned today? And where did you work? Blessed be the one who took notice of you. So she told her mother-in-law with whom she had worked and said, this man's name with whom I work today is Boaz. Then Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, blessed be he of the Lord who has not forsaken his kindness to the living and to the dead. And Naomi said to her, this man is a relation of ours, one of our close relatives. Ruth the Moabitess said, he also said to me, you shall stay close to my young men until they have finished all my harvest. And Naomi said to Ruth, her daughter-in-law, it is good, my daughter, that you should go out with his young women, and that the people do not meet you in another field. Verse 23, so she stayed close by the young women of Boaz and to glean until the end of the barley harvest and wheat harvest, and she dwelt with her mother-in-law. Today, we're going to be looking at Ruth chapter 2 and breaking it down into two parts, two pieces today. Verses 1 through 13, we see this whole concept of unmerited favor being poured out on Ruth, 1 through 13. And then verses 14 through 23, it's grace upon grace, that grace is met with even more grace. Now, when we read this, we may be tempted to think, oh, how fortunate that everything just happened to work out for them, that they left Moab, they made this long journey, they got back. It just happened to be the beginning of the barley harvest, and it just so happens that she, we even read that, don't we? Look how it says there in verse 3. And she happened to come to the part of the field belonging to Boaz. She just happens to wander into Boaz's field, and he happens to take notice of her. And oh, how nice that this story worked out for her. That when we read this, we've got to understand that there is an unseen spiritual dimension at work all around us, at all times, in all things. That's the truth. That's the reality. You don't see it. You don't always recognize it. Sometimes you misunderstand it and you end up fighting the wrong fights or going into battle for the wrong things or being manipulated by the spiritual world. But there is the truth is that there is a spiritual dimension at work around us at all times, in all ways, in all things. And this also means that nothing is merely physical. Nothing is merely physical. There is a spiritual world all around us at work. Notice what it says in Romans 8:28. This is a very familiar verse, but I want to draw your attention to a word in this verse that is sometimes we just kind of pass by. It says this, "And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose." So the question I want to ask you is, how much is everything? What does that include? What does that include? You see, coincidence is inconsistent with a biblical worldview. If you truly believe Scripture, if you say, I believe the Bible, I believe that God is the author of the Scripture and that God is giving us spiritual reality, then you've got to conclude that coincidence is inconsistent with a spiritual biblical worldview. For the Christian, there's no such thing as coincidence. Something else is taking place. God is orchestrating things together. Now, when we read this verse, we don't read everything is good, do we? No, we read that God even takes the bad stuff and he can turn it for good. But everything falls under this category. There's nothing that's not in this category that God is working in all things. We may not be able to see how God's working. We may not be able to predict what God's going to do. But the truth is, God's at work. God is working, and everything has a spiritual tone to it. And if we would submit ourselves to that and begin to get in line with that, then we would see the way that God's working. The truth is that there are miraculous things happening all around you, all day, every day, but we miss it not because God's not doing it, but because our perspective is off. And if we would get in line with the spiritual reality, if we would see what God is doing, then we would be able to understand it from his perspective. And a whole new dimension of life opens up. Seeing God work for them should provoke faith within us to believe that he'll do the same in our lives. God came through for them. That's not just, oh, what a great story. That should provoke us to say, God will come through for me. God will take care of me as well. It probably won't be some rich guy dropping money on the ground in front of you. It could be. But it probably won't be that. It's probably going to look different. It's probably going to feel different, but it's still the Lord. So let's look at verses 1 through 13 together and this idea of unmerited favor. Look back at verse 1. We read this. It says, "There was a relative of Naomi's husband, a man of great wealth, of the family of Elimelech, and his name was Boaz." Boaz. Maybe he had great abs, but it's Boaz. The stage is set here. Remember, we look back at chapter 1, verse 21, and that Naomi's talking about how she came back empty. Verse 22 of chapter 1 says this, "Naomi returned, and Ruth the Moabitess, her daughter-in-law with her, and who returned from the country of Moab." It says, "Now they came to Bethlehem at the beginning of the barley harvest." It's the start of the barley harvest. And we also see that there's a certain wealthy man that's identified for us in verse 1 as these ideas flow together. Just as an aside, the chapter breaks are not inspired by God. They're just there for our reference point. So we've got to be able to kind of bleed these ideas together, that there's not a pause in the narrative, okay? That these are thoughts that flow together. And so we see verses 22 of chapter 1 and verse 1 of chapter 2, they go together, that the stage is being set, that Boaz is there, he's a wealthy man, and he's identified as being of the family of Elimelech. And we see that idea being given to us about 3 or 4 times in this single chapter of Scripture, that he's identified as being of Elimelech's family. Now, one of the details that we're told about Boaz is that he is, look there, a man of great wealth, a man of great wealth. This phrase is also translated throughout the Bible a different way. And as soon as I say it to you, you're gonna be very familiar with this. If you've read through the Old Testament, then you're familiar with this phrase because it's spoken of a great number of different people within Scripture. But this phrase, man of great wealth, is also translated mighty man of valor. Is that familiar? Same thing. A mighty man of valor. So it can mean a lot of different things. And as we look at Boaz, we're going to see that he's a landowner. He has employees that are working for him. So yes, he's wealthy. But something that's being given to us here right from the beginning, the first thing we're told about Boaz is that he is a man of integrity. He is a man of honor. That he loves the Lord. And he puts God first. And even the very first thing that we see Boaz say as he shows up is, God bless you. That's pretty amazing that we are being specifically told some certain things about Boaz. And it's very important for us to grasp this, that not only is he a man of wealth financially, but he is also a man of wealth and character. That's who Boaz is. And so Naomi and Ruth, they've made it back to Bethlehem and they've got somewhere to stay. They're living somewhere, but now they need some food. So they got to figure out, how are we going to get food? How does this work? And what are we going to do? And so Ruth decides to go out into the fields to work to provide for them. And the reason she does this is because there was a provision in God's law for this exact kind of a situation to take place. I'll put it on the screen for you and read it. It's Leviticus chapter 19, verses 9 and 10. It says this: when you harvest the crops of your land, do not harvest the grain along the edges of your field, and do not pick up what the harvesters drop. It's the same with your grape crop. Do not strip every last bunch of grapes from the vines, and do not pick up the grapes that fall on the ground. Leave them for the poor and the foreigners living among you. I am the Lord your God. Notice how God brings his authority to this and says, I'm telling you this because I'm your God. I want you to do this because I am your God. It's an act of faith, isn't it? I mean, think about it. If you have a field, and that field equals money, that this is your way of providing, you're going to get every single last stalk of grain. I'm not going to just leave it out there. You just throw $5 on the ground and just leave it there? Is that what you do? No, nobody does that. If you drop money, you pick it up, even a quarter. My wife's in love with quarters. I don't know what it is, but she loves quarters, and she's always trying to get more of them. And if a quarter falls on the ground, she's going to pick that thing up. She's not going to leave it there. But God says, hey, I don't want you guys to live like that. I don't want you to do this with your grapes. I don't want you to do this with your fields. What they would do is they would leave the edges of their fields. They would leave the corners of their fields. They would just leave them untouched. And they would leave them untouched as an act of obedience and faith to the Lord, and also as an opportunity for somebody else. This was good. It's good for the farmer, but it was also good for the poor. Essentially, what we read in Leviticus 19 is that this is God's welfare system. How amazing that he thought of this way back then. And this is the best kind of welfare system that there ever could be. And let me tell you why. Because number one, it's good for the farmer. Because it's an opportunity for the farmer or the landowner or the one who's more wealthy to be generous. It's a chance for them to act in faith to the Lord, to say, the only reason I even have this is because God gave it to me. That I'm not puffed up and haughty and think I'm great and look how much work I put in and I'm awesome. But God's blessed me. He's taking care of me. And so I'm going to trust him with my stuff. And I'm going to leave this there and act in faith to the Lord and obedience to him. I'm going to be generous. Because generosity is at the very heart of the gospel. We referenced John 3:16 last week. I'll reference it again. The whole point of John 3:16 is God so loved that he gave. Generosity is at the heart of the gospel. If God wasn't generous to you and to me, we would have no hope of salvation. But he loves us. And he's generous to us. So generous that he would adopt us as his own kids. Not only is it good for the farmer, it's good for the one who has, but it's also good for the poor. Because this is an opportunity for them to work. It's an opportunity for them to do something. It's a chance for them to do this because no work equals no dignity. They're able to retain their dignity by going and doing something for themselves. That they have a chance to go out and to take part in doing something. Notice that God didn't say, if you own a field, make sure you harvest everything, take part of it, put it in a truck, go deliver it to the poor. It doesn't say that. It says, leave it out there in the field, and if they want it, they can go get it. There's a chance for them to go work for it. There's a chance for them to go do something for it. And I think that when we, as a nation or as a people, when we just give handouts to people, we're not helping anybody. People don't need a handout. They need a hand up. They need help. Sure, be generous. Give. We should do this. Absolutely. But don't take people's dignity by not giving them an opportunity to do something for themselves. by giving, putting their own effort into it. This is the way of the Lord. This is what God tells them to do. And so Ruth sets out into the fields to do the hard work of manual labor. And it's in the process of her going that God directs her path. Notice that. We see that here. It says, verse 2, so Ruth the Moabitess said to Naomi, please let me go to the field. She knows from Scripture, maybe Ruth and Naomi are talking through Scripture. And Naomi says, hey, turns out we're both widows. There's no way for us to work. Here's God's provision for us. And so Ruth says, I'll do it. Naomi, you're old. Let me do this. You don't need to go out in the field and work yourself up over this. I'll take care of us. And so Ruth says, let me go out and I'll do this. And so she begins to go. And as she goes, God directs her path. It says, verse 3, she happened to come to the part of the field that belonged to Boaz, who was of the family of Elimelech. Notice they didn't sit in their house waiting for God to provide. They didn't just sit around saying, God, we're hungry. Why don't you take care of us? They did something. They did what they could. And what they could do is go to the field and just try to do something. And so she decides, I'm going to go to the field. And as she goes, she's not sure where she's going. And she doesn't just wait for this beam of light. Oh, you know, God says, go to this field. Here's where you're going to find. She just goes. And she starts, there's some people over there. I guess I'll go that way. And so she goes and she finds some people over there and she starts to look, work and move. And it wasn't that an angel appeared or a supernatural light beam from heaven, that it was just her willingness to do something. God at times will move in a supernatural way in your life. I hope you've experienced those kinds of things. That just these crazy supernatural things take place that are unexplainable other than God's miraculous intervention in your life. God does do that from time to time. But what I've noticed in my life, and probably you've noticed the same, is that God tends to not work that way all the time. Typically, the way that God works is in very supernaturally natural ways. It just feels very normal. It feels very natural. And yet there's a supernatural component to it. There's a part of it where it just kind of worked out. And what we've got to realize is that that's not just circumstance or coincidence just working it out. That's the hand of the Lord. That God's putting things together in our lives. That typically, for the most part, the way that God moves and works is he works in very supernaturally natural ways. That's what you're going to experience for the most part in your life. Sure, God's going to come through in these major supernatural spiritual things. But for the most part, it's just going to feel very natural. But it's the Lord. It's the hand of God moving in your life. When we read in verse 3, and she happened to come across this field, we need to be sure that when we read these kind of verses in the Bible, that we don't see random coincidence, but divine providence. Divine providence. Now, I want to define this for you, okay? Because this is a theological term that we've got to get, and so I'm going to refer to a super nerd named Norman Geisler. If you don't have this systematic theology book, get it and read it. It's kind of like reading a dictionary, but it's amazing. I have it written down for you because you have to see these words as I say them, otherwise your brain's going to get twisted in knots, okay? So the way this works is we're going to read through this. But Norman Geisler in his systematic theology book on page 688, he says this about divine providence. He says, it's a careful arrangement prepared beforehand for the accomplishment of predetermined ends. That's divine providence. Careful arrangement prepared beforehand for the accomplishment of predetermined ends. That God's accomplishing something. He's doing something. He's predetermined it, and he's arranging things from his will, from his perspective to accomplish this. But this is something that God is doing. To go a little bit deeper with this idea, he says this, God is not only the producer of creation, but he's also the preserver of it. He not only produced it and preserves it, but he also provides for it, okay? So this is what God's doing. He produces creation, he provides for creation, and preserves creation. That there are three parts to this. Now, in this, there's a contrast with what God is doing. These ideas work together, but they're not the same thing, okay? So here, take a look at it at this way. So the contrast, I'm trying to get out of the way, but I'm having a hard time doing it. Let me go over here. All right, so the contrast can be looked at like this. So that creation explains the world's existence. God created it, right? It explains that God did create this. it's coming to be. That this is what God has done in creating. Preservation explains the world's continuance. That the world continues to be because of God's intervention. Right? He made it, but it's not that God just took some molecules and said, let's see what happens. And just kind of threw it out there. That he's doing something else. That he's actually involved with his creation. He's causing it to continue to be. It's continuance. Thirdly, number two, that single argument destroys the whole concept of evolution. That's what the whole basis of evolution is. And so when you take evolution and then you try to add theology or creationist to it and try to make some sort of weird hybrid, what you get is a God that kind of started it and then is hands off. But that's not the God of the Bible. That's not the way that God is shown. He's not only in creation, but also in preservation. And thirdly, what we're looking at is this one, providence. Providence explains the world's control, its direction of being. Not only did God create it, not only is God sustaining it, but he also has a will. He has a desire. He has a direction that he wants to accomplish. And he is able to exercise his will within creation. And as he exercises his will within creation, he's able to orchestrate things in a very supernaturally natural way so that you happen to come upon things. He already has a plan for Ruth. He already knows what he's going to do. He already knows that he's putting Ruth and Boaz together and that he's going to provide for Ruth and Naomi miraculously through this man Boaz. But not only is he just doing that, but he's doing something much, much bigger in terms of painting a picture of redemption. Isn't that our story? Isn't that the whole theme of what we're looking at today? This whole concept of the book of Ruth is that it's a story of redemption. Because Ruth and Boaz don't just represent Ruth and Boaz. They represent you and me and Jesus. That Ruth is you and me. That Boaz is Jesus. He's our Redeemer. He's the one who rescues us. He's the one who cares for us. And you may just happen to find yourself here today. You may just happen to find yourself among God's people. Or maybe you think back to when you got saved, and I don't really know how I got there, but somehow I was there and I was confronted with the gospel and the Lord, he saved me. In your mind, it seems like random coincidence. But from God's perspective, it was providence, divine providence. He knew exactly what he was doing. He knew exactly how he was drawing you to that moment. And so we can't see coincidence. We can't see random circumstance. God didn't just create the universe, but he's also active within his creation for his glory and for our good. God is active within his creation. So verses 4 through 13, we see that God brings Ruth and Boaz together, and we see romance begin within their relationship. Verse 4, it says this, "Now behold, Boaz came from Bethlehem, and said to the reapers, 'The Lord be with you.' And they answered him, 'The Lord bless you.'" Let me ask you a question. When's the last time you were on a construction site? When's the last time you were around a bunch of, you know, blue-collar dudes? That's my job. Every day I'm working around some guys, and we're working, and we're doing stuff together. And I'll tell you that when you find yourself around a bunch of men doing manual labor, it's much easier for you to find cursing than it is for you to find blessing. This should strike us as absolutely crazy. What if you went to work and your boss showed up and said, "Hey, God bless you"? That would be the best job ever. My boss wants the Lord to bless me? How amazing is that? My boss cares about how God is with my relationship with him? That's amazing. And so Boaz shows up. He says, "God bless you guys." And so he begins to, we start to see a little bit more about the character of Boaz. That he's a man who cares about the things of the Lord. He cares about the people who work for him. He shows up and he wants them to be cared for. He wants God's blessing in their life. And so he's saying these things. But as he does that, we see in verse 5 that he notices that there's someone there that he doesn't recognize. Think about this. This is a small town. This is rural, you know, rural country folk that are working out in the fields. He knows everybody who is there. He knows all the workers who are there. He knows who all the different people who are in desperate situations, the poor people who are out there to work to glean and care for themselves. And he notices, I don't know who that is. They're out here, they're following my reapers, but I don't know who that is. And so he goes to his foreman and he says, hey, who's that? Who is that? Who's that young lady over there? And he asks about her. And he begins to get some answers about her. Whose young woman is this? Though we see Boaz asking about this, we see that Boaz is noticing her and wondering about her. And so the servants, verse 6, the servant who was in charge of the reapers answered and said, it's the young Moabite woman who came back with Naomi from the country of Moab. Look at verse 7, what it says. And she said, this is what Ruth said to this foreman. And she said, please let me glean and gather after the reapers among the sheaves. So she asks permission to do this. Now, does she have to ask permission? No, she could have said, hey, according to Leviticus 19, I have the right to do this, so back off me. I'm going to go and grab my stuff. But she doesn't do that, right? She just shows up and she asks permission. She shows this attitude of humility, this attitude of submission, this attitude of meekness. She shows up she takes the initiative to do it, right? She's going out there to do it. So she's doing it in a very strong and yet submissive kind of a way. She's doing something really significant. And I think it shows us not only the character of Boaz, but also the character of Ruth. Turn in your Bibles to Proverbs chapter 31. I want to read a couple of verses here for you. It's one of those sections of scripture that we hear about pretty often in terms of being the Proverbs 31 woman. And I think that it shows us something really significant here, and something is shown to us by the way that Ruth is conducting herself that's really consistent with what Proverbs 31 says. I want to read verses 10 through 17 together and take a look at these verses. Proverbs 31, it's the last proverb. It says this, verse 10, who can find a virtuous wife? For her worth is far above rubies. The heart of her husband safely trusts her, so he will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not evil all the days of her life. She seeks wool and flax and willingly works with her hands. She's like the merchant ships. She brings her food from afar. She also rises while it is yet night and provides food for her household and a portion for her maidservants. She considers a field and buys it. And from her profits, she plants a vineyard. She girds herself with strength and strengthens her arms. And you can continue on. There's a whole bunch of really amazing things to say there. But I wanted to take that snapshot out and say, don't you see Ruth? Don't you see Ruth in this? She's virtuous. She's willing to work. She's working by the strength of her arm. She's willing to get up early and to go provide food for her household. She's not going to just sit back and wait to see what happens. She's going to go do something. She's going to take the initiative and go do something. And so she's the embodiment of this concept of Proverbs 31. Now, Scripture never says anything about the beauty of Ruth, but you probably, when thinking of Ruth, you think of this really beautiful woman. And I'm not sure if she was or not. Scripture doesn't tell us necessarily if her physical beauty was there, but I kind of tend to think maybe she was pretty normal, just kind of normal, just like any normal woman. And so she's there working in the field, and Boaz takes notice of her, but the beauty of Ruth that we see has to do with her virtue. Not necessarily her physical appearance. It has to do with who she is inside. And that's where Scripture says, women, don't let your beauty just be on the outside, the adorning of yourself with braided hair or costly jewelry or fine clothes or whatever. There's nothing wrong with those things. But if that's the only source of your beauty, then you have an issue. You have a problem. But there needs to be a hidden beauty within your heart. There needs to be something that is far deeper in terms of that beauty. Some of the most physically attractive people I've ever seen have been the most ugly people I've ever known. And vice versa, some of the people who are very common, very normal looking, maybe not stand out in any way, are the most beautiful people I've ever known. That's because beauty has so much more to do with who we are inside than it has to do with what people see on the outside. And so somehow Ruth stands out, not only just because she's someone he doesn't know, but he starts to get attracted to her. there's this attraction starting to come up, and we see that he starts to kind of pursue her a little bit. And so we see in verse 9, it says, "Then Boaz said to Ruth, 'You will listen, my daughter, will you not? Do not glean in another field nor go from here, but stay close by my young women. Let your eyes be on the field which they reap and go after them. Have I not commanded the young men not to touch you? And when you are thirsty, go to the vessels and drink from where the young, from what the young men have drawn.'" And so Boaz extends grace to Ruth to feel welcomed. He says, "I'm going to take care of you, Ruth. Don't worry about anything. Don't stress out about how it's all going to go. Don't go to another field. Stay in my field. I've told the young men to leave you alone. And if you are thirsty, don't draw your own water. They already took care of it. Just go over where my employees are getting a drink and just take some. You're welcome to all of it." He extends grace to her. Does she deserve any of this? No. She's a foreigner. She's someone who doesn't belong, and yet he graciously gives her what she never could have asked for. She doesn't deserve this treatment, and yet Ruth is made to feel welcomed. She's given protection. She's cared for. And when he says, "Stay in my field," he's saying, "I'm going to provide for you." That's what he's saying to her. "I'll take care of you." And he's giving her all of these things. Ruth has come for a certain reason, we're told. Boaz, she basically falls on her face and says, "I don't deserve all of this. Why would you take notice of me?" And then Boaz says in verse 11, "I know why you're here. I know that you've, since the death of your husband, you've come back to take care of your mother-in-law. And that's an amazing thing." And look at verse 12. It says, "The Lord will repay your work and fully reward, and a full reward be given to you by the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings you have come for refuge." We're given a certain specific thing about her that is said to us here, that she has come to seek refuge under the provision of the Lord. And so this is part of who Ruth is, that she's seeking refuge in the Lord, and that's why she's even come to Israel. Not only do we see that she is given unmerited favor, which is this whole idea of grace, but we see that in the second half of this chapter, that she's given grace upon grace. It's not just that she's been provided for. This would be enough. "Hey, just stay in my field. I'll take care of you, and you'll have enough." This would be far more than she ever thought she could have gotten. But now we're going to see that God gives even more, that it's grace upon grace in her life. Notice what it says in verse 14 through 16. It says this, "Now Boaz said to her at mealtime," where it says now, this is some time has passed, okay? So he said to her, "Go ahead and go glean, stay in my field," and then some time passes, and now Boaz said to her at mealtime, Come here and eat of the bread and dip your piece of bread in the vinegar." So she sat beside the reapers and he passed parched grain to her. And she ate and was satisfied and kept some back. And when she had rose up to glean, Boaz commanded his young men, saying, "Let her glean even among the sheaves and do not reproach her. Also let grain from the bundles fall purposely for her and leave it that she may glean and do not rebuke her." Notice what's taking place here, that Boaz has some time to think about what's going on here as the workday progresses. So the workday progresses on. He sees her going out there, and she's, you know, just like going back to maybe the physical appearance of Ruth. She's working hard. She's doing some manual labor. She's out in the field. She's probably kind of sweaty and, you know, maybe flush and, you know, maybe disheveled a little bit. There's not this. It's not like she's wearing this makeup, and they didn't really have that then. But, you know, she's not like all done up and, you know, just kind of picking up a piece of grain at a time. And, you know, no, she's working really hard. If I don't get this, we don't eat, right? She's got a lot of motivation to make sure that she's doing really well. But something's happening within Boaz. There's this attraction starting to unfold here. Somehow something is taking place. And as the day progresses, he decides to pursue Ruth a little bit more. He's going to kind of test the waters and kind of see, you know, what if I talk to her a little bit? What's going to happen? You know, if I invite her to come eat with me, would she come? Or is she like, "Nah, I'm good, bro. Thanks. You're kind of weird, and I'm just going to sit over here and eat over here." And so they take a break for lunch, and Boaz finds Ruth and invites her to sit with him to enjoy a good meal. And so he says, "Hey, here, dip your bread in this. It's this vinegar mixture." It's kind of like when you go to Olive Garden and they, you know, have the little plates in the bowl and they pour the stuff there and you like dip your bread in that. It's like that, okay? The bread's good. It's awesome. But when you dip it in the stuff, it's even better, Right, so that's kind of what's going on here. He's like, hey, have you had this before? Check this out. And they're striking up this conversation and just having a meal together. And as they do this, they're just enjoying food. And this dipping sauce was also a sign of favor. Do you remember when we were in John 13, when Jesus dipped the piece and he gave it to Judas, and that's when he identified Judas as his betrayer? We talked about how that dipping of the bread was also a signifying thing of favor. Okay, so that's something that they would do. It's not necessarily telling us that Boaz has found favor in Ruth, but it's kind of a similar concept all being laid out here. Now, when the break is over, notice that what Boaz does in verse 15, it says, and when she rose up to glean, Boaz commanded his young men. So they get up all to go back to work, and he goes, hey guys, come here real quick. He has a little secret meeting with his guys. He says, okay, you guys know this girl Ruth? Here's what I want you to do, all right? So let her take whatever she wants, even from the sheaves. What the sheaves are is, so they would go along, they would harvest it, and then they would bundle it all up, and then they would stack it up. And so he's saying, even if she wants to take some of that, just let her take it. According to the law, she wasn't allowed to take from what they had bundled up. Only if it fell on the ground and only what was off to the side, she could take whatever that was. And so he says, just let her take whatever. I mean, just offer it to her. Just say, here, you want some of this? And then he says, you know what? Here, this is even better. Just walk in front of her and then just drop some. And just keep going. And Ruth, you know, she goes out to glean and she's like, oh, look. Look at this huge pile. This is amazing. She walks over here. Oh, another pile. Wow, God is so good. How did I happen to get this much? This is amazing. And so she's completely clueless of what's going on. She's just kind of going about her day, and these guys are just, you know, finding Ruth and just throwing some on the ground. And it's this amazing thing that's taking place. And she doesn't know what's going on. She's just like, man, this gleaning thing's so easy. Why doesn't everybody do this? So she's out there working. You see, Boaz is starting to pursue her a little bit more. Man, I just, as I was thinking about this, I was thinking about you and maybe your wife. Do you remember how you got her to like you? It wasn't because you're awesome. I just in case you were wondering. Somehow God tricked her into liking you. I don't know how it happened, but somehow he blinded her eyes and you were there. And you had to do some, for me, I had to buy lots of steak for my wife in order to get her to like me. It paid off, you know, so if you're single, hey, try that. I don't know, maybe it'll work for you. But in all that, remember how you got her. And I think that we have a hard time with that, because what we end up doing is we end up falling away from that. I work so hard just to get her attention. I'm willing to pay such a deep price. Guys, just throw money on the ground. I want her to be taken care of. You're willing to pay the expense, to go the extra mile, to do more, to open the door, to pull out her chair, to take her to that nice dinner, to be able to provide whatever she would want, to always say yes, to put on your best. And then somewhere along the way, we start doing less of that and less of that and less of that. And it becomes more about what you didn't do for me instead of what I'm doing for you. And to the degree that that helps you, and to the degree that that's convicting for you, let the Lord lead you on that. But I think, men, that we need to go back to that. That we need to be able to pay attention to her. The question is, have you stopped that? Have you slowed down in those things? And maybe it's time to take some of that back up, to return to those first works. In verses 17 through 19, we see that Ruth works really hard. And she takes her day's gleanings back to Naomi. Look at what it says in verse 17. It says, she gleaned in the field until evening. So what that means is that this is kind of like a sunrise to sunset kind of a job. You work during harvest time from the time you have light until the sun goes down. Because that's when you have time to work. And so they would work during harvest time like crazy. And so she's out there. She's taking a little break when everyone else takes breaks, but she's working hard. And so then she takes all of what she has gleaned, all of what she's picked up, and she goes, and we're told that then after that, she beat out what she had gleaned, and it was about an ephah of barley. So she goes, and after working a full day, it's now dark, then she goes and she threshes this barley. What that means is what they would do is they would take their what they had harvested. They would go up on these on the hilltops and they would use the wind in order to separate the wheat from the chaff, the kernel from the outside part that you can't really use, you can't really work use. And so what they would do is they would beat it or they would crush it, they would stamp it, and then they would put it like in a blanket. They would stand up on these hilltops and they would use the wind. They'd throw it up in the air. And as the wind blew by, they would the chaff would blow away, and the kernels would fall back down. And so that's how they would separate their wheat or their barley. And so she does this after a full day's work, so that now she has something useful. Because if you don't separate it, well, that's cute that you have some barley, but we can't use that. We've got to actually separate it in order to be able to use it. And we're told that she has about an ephah. That's about 5.5 gallons. Okay, so she didn't just come back with like a little cup, right? She's got 5 gallons. She's got a wheelbarrow full of this stuff. And now she's got to figure out how to get it back home. And so she's trying to take it all back home. And she gets it back home. And she shows up with Naomi. And she shows Naomi, hey, so I went and I was in this field and I was taken care of. And it says there in verse 18, she took it up and went to the city. And her mother-in-law saw what she had gleaned. So she brought out and gave to her what she had kept back after she had been satisfied. So that was when she had eaten with Boaz and she had dipped her bread. And then it says she ate and was satisfied and then she kept some back. So she like asked for a doggy bag or maybe she just kind of looked around and grabbed some, and, you know, whatever she did. But she had some more. And so she took that back and she's like, check it out. Look what I got. Look at the day's work that I've got today. And she just thinks this is so good. This is amazing. And notice verse 19, what Naomi says. She goes, where have you gleaned today? Where have you been? Because she notices, look at that, it says, blessed be the one who took notice of you. Ruth is just kind of going through the motions and just doing what she's supposed to do. But Naomi looks at that and says, whoa, whoa, whoa. You should have gotten far less than what you've gotten today. You've been hooked up. What's going on here? Where have you been? And so she's putting the pieces together, even though Ruth doesn't know what's going on. And Ruth here says, well, I don't know. There's this guy named Boaz. And she's like, what? Boaz? Look at verse 20. Then Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, blessed be he of the Lord who has not forsaken his kindness to the living and to the dead. And Naomi said to her, this man is a relation of ours, one of our close relatives. She's mind blown at this point. She sees God's providence. Naomi understands God is taking care of us. She sees it's not just random chance that you happen to be in Boaz's field. It's not just random chance that you brought home this much. This is more than we need to survive. He's bankrolling us right now. This is amazing what's taking place. And so she's putting all this together and she says, Ruth, you've got to check this out. And so Ruth finally understands what we were told all the way back in chapter 2, verse 1, that Boaz is part of Elimelech's family. There's something else taking place here. There's something deeper going on. And not only do we see that Boaz is a man in a very unique position to be able to be this kinsman redeemer, like we're going to talk about in a minute, but also beyond this, that Boaz has taken notice of Ruth. This is grace upon grace. And so Naomi identifies Boaz as being in Elimelech's family, but even more than that, that he's a close relative. That this idea of close relative is the Hebrew word goel, G-O-E-L, which means a kinsman redeemer. That's the whole concept. A kinsman redeemer, someone who is a close relative. This comes from, I'm going to give you a couple of references. I'm going to talk about them. We're not going to turn there or read them because they're bigger pieces, but you can write them down if you'd want to. In Deuteronomy chapter 25, verses 5 through 10, we'll put that on the screen so that you can write it down if you want to. Basically, what that tells us is that if a man dies with no kids, then it's the job of the younger brothers to marry that wife and to raise up kids for that family. So, you know, if the oldest brother is getting married, then the other brothers are going to kind of be like, hey, bro, what's she like? Because they got a stake in this. If you die, I got to marry her. So, you know, there's kind of a family affair going on here. I don't know if I really like her. Maybe you should try somebody else or whatever. And so there's kind of something deeper going on with this, and that there's this idea that if someone does this, it's the duty of the brother. It's the responsibility of the brother to marry his wife, and that their firstborn son would then be considered the son of the dead guy. So under the under Jewish law, you could be dead for 10 years and still have kids. Right? So that's kind of how that takes place. And so they would be raised up, and that would be so the name would carry on. Also, we see in Leviticus chapter 27, verses 19 through 25, that this kinsman would also have the responsibility to buy the property, keeping it in the family's name. Okay, so that way the land would stay within the family's name. And so there's the kind of a number of things going on here. And what we're supposed to see in this, as we look at this, is Jesus. And here's why. Because Jesus is our kinsman redeemer. It's the foreshadowings of what's going to take place next week. That he alone, Jesus alone, has the power and authority to rescue us from the plight of our fallen state. Ruth couldn't rescue herself. There's nothing she could do for herself. There's no way she could provide for herself. She was at the mercy of someone else. She needed that Goel. She needed that kinsman redeemer. And so too it is with you and me. We can't care for ourselves. We can't provide for ourselves. We can't free ourselves from the debt of sin. We need the Goel. We need the kinsman redeemer. We need someone who's close enough to us, but someone who's also elevated above us in order to take care of us. You see, not only is Jesus the kinsman redeemer because he has the power and authority, but he's also in the unique position of being our kinsman because he took on flesh and became a man. That he's in the right position because he's God, but he's also close to us because Jesus became a man. And in becoming a man, he took on flesh in order to pay for our sin, that we might have access to God, that we might be cared for. And just like Ruth, there's no reason we should find favor in Jesus' sight, but he loves us anyway. He loves us anyway. So we see Naomi tells Ruth to be certain that she's only in Boaz's field. Look at there in verse 21. After Ruth finds out who this guy Boaz is, then Ruth says, "Oh, I've got more info. He also said to me, 'You shall stay close by my young men until they have finished all the harvest.'" And Naomi said to Ruth, her daughter-in-law, "It is good, my daughter, that you should go out with his young women and that people did not meet you in any other field." She tells her, make sure you're only in Boaz's field. Now, I mean, that's kind of like a duh statement. I just took 5 gallons of barley. Like, I'm going to go back tomorrow for sure, right? But she says, make sure you do this. And I think what we see in this is that so long as Ruth was willing to look for provision in Boaz's field, she was cared for. So too it is for us, that so long as we look for our provision and satisfaction from the Lord, we're going to be filled. But as soon as we look to other fields of the world, as soon as we go and we start to look for life there, we're going to be empty and forsaken because they can't provide what we need. They can't take care of us the way that we need to. And so the admonition for Ruth is the same for us. Don't get caught in another field. Stay in the fields of the Lord. Stay where he is. He'll care for you. It may not feel like it from time to time. It may not seem like it in the moment, but he's caring for you. The coincidence isn't just a coincidence, it's his hand for you. And so we see in verse 23, she stayed close by the young women of Boaz and to glean until the end of the barley harvest and wheat harvest, and she went and she dwelt with her mother-in-law. So time's passing, she goes day in and day out to care for them. And we see that Ruth is being brought nearer to Boaz. And next week we're going to see how this idea of a kinsman redeemer unfolds even deeper and the connection between Boaz and Jesus. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your word today. We thank you for the chance to study it together, and we pray that you would help us to apply it to our lives. Lord, we pray that you would help us to not be found in another field, but that we would be found in your fields, that we would look to glean from what it is that you have for us, that we would find our satisfaction in you, and that, Jesus, your name would be made great among us. And so, Lord, we commit today to you saying thank you for it. We pray that you would be blessed by us, because we're definitely blessed by you. We pray in your name, Jesus. Amen.